Hello, welcome everyone. Thank you for coming, joining us this evening for this webinar on careers in the development sector. This webinar is primarily meant for students in economics who would like to explore careers in the development sector in future, or it's also open to anyone who would want to enter into the development sector in future. Our esteemed speaker is Dr. Nilanjana Sengupta. She is currently the technical specialist with the International Center for Research on Women, ICRW, New Delhi. She comes from a background of economics. She holds a postgraduate degree in economics and a PhD in regional development from Jawaharlal Nehru University, Delhi. And as a matter of fact, before coming to the development sector, she has taught at various premier universities. She has taught economics at various universities in Delhi, Mumbai, and Kolkata. She has 15 years of experience of working on issues of labor, livelihoods, poverty, financial inclusion, governance, and violence through a gender intersectional lens. So her major area of research and interest is, of course, gender studies. Previously, she has worked with national and international agencies such as UN Women and Azad Foundation, and has been actively involved in research, action, and policy advocacy. Thank you very much, Nilanjana, for agreeing to speak to our students, agreeing to be, be part of the webinar. And I'm of course delighted to see you after many, many years. Thank you.
First of all, thank you so much, Aprajita, for inviting me to this really, really exciting webinar. And thank you to RV University and the Economics Department for having me here. I think it is a very interesting moment for me to actually share with people who will be taking this journey through economics, and to share with them that beyond some of the mainstream sort of destinations that economic students always arrive at, so be it higher academic or be it teaching or industry, there are also now a range of occupational choices, a range of professions, which really welcome economists and where economists can actually make a lot of difference. So it's also a moment of joy. It's a moment of, sort of sharing with all of you my own journey and the prospects that we can see out there. So as Aprajita has shared, and while I speak, let me also start sharing the PPT. Just a second, give me a moment. Okay, great. So as I was sharing that, my own journey has been a very interesting one. So like all students of economics, after doing my master's and in fact my MPhil, I started teaching undergraduate economics in Delhi University, then social and political issues. And that made me enter the space of, university level gender studies, development studies, where there was an opportunity to work with the society, with the polity on different kinds of thematics. And so from there began that journey. And in around 2015, because I was very interested in doing research, which is at the sort of cutting edge of action and policy, that is why I moved into the development sector. So what I bring to the development sector is the training of economics and a lot of the analytical and conceptual sort of understanding that comes with it, and also bring that to bear upon the work that I do in terms of action and policy making. So that's so much for my own journey. So to move on, right. So what does economics teach us? So many of you who I hope will be joining the economics department at the RV University, one question that all of you must be sort of having in your mind is, what is it that economics will be teaching us? So primarily, economics is a study of economic relationships between individuals or households, and communities, societies, and also between countries. And what is this? What does this economic relationship sort of spread across? What are the institutions? So we are looking at production relations. We are looking at consumption relations. We are also looking at distribution. By production, we are talking about a range of goods and services that every country, every economy produces in every year. But by consumption, it is about how households and as individuals, we are consuming those products. So we are consuming food, we are consuming different luxury goods like TV, fan, AC, we'll be consuming cars, we'll be consuming, even shelters, our houses that are produced, all right? These are all production that is happening, or services. So your teachers are also producing a certain service, which students are also consuming. And distribution is how do you actually distribute all the goods and services produced in an economy in a year between households, between individuals, between communities in a particular country. So economics is a study of these economic relationships. And as you might be aware, economic relationships are extremely critical to every kind of social and economic phenomena that we see in this country, be it inflation, be it employment, be it, which industry is actually going to succeed, which industry will not, be it issues of poverty, be it issues of whether we have self-sufficiency in food. So all of these are guided by these economic relationships. And as I said, there are three important sites of study: households, markets, and public policy. By public policy, we are talking about the policies that the government is making. So our governments all over the world have a very critical role to play in sort of facilitating or regulating markets so that different people and different individuals, different households, different communities have access to certain goods and services or to provide certain incentives to industry. So public policy, for example, one of the most important public policies that all of us actually experience is taxation. So taxation is an important public policy. Or the street lights that we have. So the government collects taxes to be able to pay for certain very important services for people. So all of these fall under the realm of public policy. So economics helps us actually understand all these different aspects. If we look at, what are the particular areas within the study of economics which are critically important for work in what I will call the development sector, and I'll come to it in a moment, what is meant by the development sector. What are some of the important areas of study, especially within economics or the field of economics, which are relevant for the development sector? So one is we understand, we learn development theory. So we understand what is development, how can development occur, in what ways development has occurred, what are the theories guiding development. We understand about development indicators. For example, how do you say whether an economy has progressed or not, whether we are actually going ahead or we are staying at the same location or we are falling behind. So what are these development indicators? We study public policy, which I've already explained. We study labor. By labor, I'm talking about employment and also the sometimes even unpaid work. So a lot of people, especially women, perform a lot of unpaid labor within the home, in the agricultural field, or in family businesses. So how do you study labor and livelihood and employment issues? How do you study agriculture, which is the backbone of the economy, which actually produces the food, which is so essential for our sustenance? We study poverty, etc. And all of these studies, all of these understandings and studies help us and prepare us for work and research in the development sector. Very importantly, in the last 10 years, three extremely critical areas which have become very relevant for the development sector are gender, environment, and health. These are traditionally not seen as, economics topics, but nowadays in all universities within economics, you have the study of health in economics, you have the study of environmental economics. These will probably at some point be offered as specializations, etc., to students of economics or even gender economics or feminist economics. So these are extremely relevant again for the development sector. And the other very important thing, another very, very important tool that you actually get if you study, if you're a student of economics, is you get the tools of understanding data. And by data, what do we mean? So for example, there is so much happening, so many things happening within our country. Let's take the example of employment. So many sectors of employment, people working across sectors, different levels. There is a whole system able to correct the situation if anything is going wrong. So this understanding of data, analysis of this data, economics actually gives you tools. Economics also gives you tools to collect your own data, to do primary research. How do you actually collect information and data? How do you process that data? How do you analyze that data to actually help you in evaluating things, help you in understanding the gaps, and help you in which will then help you in addressing those gaps. So this is what actually economics trains us with. And this becomes a very important knowledge that you bring into the development sector. Now, coming to the development sector, now, usually when we, you know, somewhere a lay person, when she or he thinks about the development sector, she will feel, okay, these are some small NGOs working in some small ways in certain parts of the country. Of course, NGOs are there, and that's, and the kind of imagination we have, this is what we call the space of intervention. So there are certain organizations who are working directly in the field to help people have a better life. Now, this could be in the space of employment, could be in the space of health, could be in the space of education, could be in different spaces. But intervention is only one part of the development sector. Intervention, or what we call direct action, this is one part of the development sector. What is the second? What are the other parts? For example, you have a big collaborations and campaigns. Now, what do we mean by big collaboration and campaigns? So often different organizations, individuals come together nationally or globally to develop big campaigns to influence policy. For example, in India, some of the biggest campaigns which have very important relevance for our economics, for the country's economics, our right to food campaign or the campaign for right to work, which actually influenced what we have as one of the largest employment programs in the country, called the Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Program. So there was a huge campaign that was built. Now, even in this campaign, you need people with understanding of economics. You need researchers, and you also get paid to be part of these campaigns and to develop your research and develop policies and programs within these campaigns. The third kind of work that is done within the development sector is actually done by funding organizations. So you have very big funding organizations like Gates Foundation, and these could be national and international. You have several national level trusts, and in fact, RV University and the people who have made RV University would have their own trusts. You have Tata Trust. You have different trusts also in India who actually donate funds for the betterment of people, for the betterment of society. So there are funding organizations in India as well, but there are also very large international funding organizations like Gates Foundation, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, Ford Foundation, etc., etc. And these, there is a lot of job opportunity or employment opportunity within these funding organizations. Now, what are these job opportunities? You need people within these funding organizations who can decide how to spend the fund or how to distribute the funds among different activities, among different organizations. So, for example, if there are different organizations asking for funds for different kinds of things, the job of the people in the funding organization is to determine that which kind of project or which kind of job would actually be very useful for the society. So there is a lot of job opportunities within the funding organizations. Then another kind of work that we do within the development sector is monitoring and knowledge management. Now, what do we mean by this? Suppose you are doing a very important intervention. So for example, there is an NGO called Pradhan, which has built self-help groups that do savings and credit activities across the country. And there are across the country in different states, so many groups. So you need to collect that data. You need to know how many self-help groups have been formed. And forget Pradhan, even big national programs like the National Rural Livelihood Mission, which is again one of the biggest development programs carried out by the country as a whole. There is an entire monitoring and knowledge management unit which collects information on how many SHGs have been formed or self-help groups have been formed, what kind of training have been given to that, do these SHGs have access to loans, What are they doing with these loans? So this entire monitoring and knowledge management is a space by itself, and it is there in national level, government level organizations, in international organizations, in small NGOs. Everywhere you need people who can hold this monitoring and knowledge management function. Then you have another very important dimension within the development sector, which is impact evaluation. For example, consider that you have built an NGO and you have carried out an awareness campaign on reproductive health. So you are basically advising women that if you are getting pregnant, you need to be connected with hospitals, you need to have good nutrition. So you have an awareness campaign, et cetera, built around reproductive health, say. So impact evaluation would come in to say that, okay, this is your intervention, that you have built an awareness campaign, and maybe you have provided certain kinds of nutrients and medicines. And what is its impact? Are babies being born healthier? Is maternal mortality going down? Are people really beginning to access more hospitals than before? So these are the kind of questions that you answer through impact evaluation. And for this also, economists are in very high demand because we have the tools to conduct impact evaluation studies. Coming to research, of course, in research, we ask very important big questions. As I said, that, you know, you may want to ask something, you know, a really big question like what is, in which sector of the economy should the government actually invest funds? I mean, which is the sector? So for example, if you want to ask the question like, how can we increase agricultural productivity while also ensuring that the food that we eat is not being produced through pesticides? So we want to reduce the use of pesticides, but we want to increase the productivity of agriculture. So it is not just the work that agriculturalists would do. As economists, we would also be conducting research studies to look at all the business chains, all the market chains, and how this entire distribution of food is happening, how all the people, all the farmers are also getting their pesticides or their raw materials. So it is a study of those chains of relationships, and economists come in here to do that kind of research. You can have a research which actually asks you some very important questions like, you know, how can we increase women's workforce participation rate in the economy, where you're trying to understand what are the factors that are preventing women to be part of the economy in a much better way. So these are all aspects of research, and these are also conducted through the development sector and through very big research organizations in the development sector. You also have advocacy organizations. And in advocacy organizations, what happens is, again, by advocacy, we mean that you basically talk to policymakers, both national and international, to actually influence policy and help these policymakers make enabling policy that will help people to better their lives. So, for example, if you have discovered as part of your research that one of the reasons why women's workforce participation rate is very low is because women do not have access to certain training opportunities, or women do not have access to certain credit opportunities, then you will advocate with the policymakers to devise a policy that will ensure that women are able to access these kinds of opportunities like training or credit. So advocacy is a very important part of the research that we do in the development sector, because our research is meant to make the world a better place. So we have to talk to those people who are taking decisions, making policies, so that we can influence those people to make the world a better place. So advocacy is also another very important work, and you also have a lot of people in advocacy, working in advocacy and earning very well. In advocacy, institutions or often organizations collaborate together to create advocacy platforms, which also employ people. And then the last part is, of course, communication. So no matter what you do, whether it is an intervention, whether it is a collaboration, whether it is a research, you need to talk about it. You need to communicate, write about it, talk about it, show it, make a film, write your reports, create a seminar or a webinar of this kind. So communications, where you are communicating to the grassroots people, you're communicating to peer organizations, you're communicating with the government, you're communicating with the donors. That again is another very important part of the development sector. Now, coming to just to give you a very, and I'll run through this slide very quickly so that we have more time on the next slide. So what is the brief background of the development sector? Why didn't we hear so much about it, let's say 30 years back? Why is it so important now? So in fact, if you see that till the 1980s or about the big, till the 1980s, a large part of all kinds of development work was actually led by the government itself. But from the 1980s, and especially in India from the 1990s, when we have liberalization, globalization, the government was not in a position to spend that kind of money on actually a lot of development projects. Also, people realize that the government, because it is not always in very direct contact with the grassroots, it may not really understand the needs of the grassroots and may not be able to respond appropriately. Thereby, there was a growth of the development sector from the 1990s, and we see NGOs, research or development sector research organizations, advocacy platforms, sort of rising everywhere in the country. So there was a huge plethora of these organizations. So as I've written here, some of the enabling factors was, of course, the withdrawal of the government or the inability of the government to respond to different kinds of development needs and issues. And the other thing was, you know, all over the world, there was also a shift in approach from a growth-oriented approach to a development-oriented approach. Now, what do I mean by that? You see, especially in India, in the first, let's say, 3-4 decades after independence, one of the most important thoughts with the government was that we need to increase our gross domestic product, meaning we need to increase whatever the total amounts of goods and services that we produce. But gradually, there was a realization that it is not enough to produce. We need to distribute these goods in such a way that there is greater equality, that people, especially from disadvantaged backgrounds, have access to these goods and services. Therefore, there came the idea of development, which is looking at not just, you know, growth, but it is also looking at access to education, access to health. It is also looking at distributional aspects of income. And we also have the idea of multidimensional poverty. So poverty is not just lack of income, but poverty is also about your lack of opportunities, your lack of good health, because you're not eating properly, so you do not have good health, or you do not have access to hospitals and good doctors, you do not have access to the best kind of education, which then again puts you in this loop of poverty because you don't have a means of escaping that poverty. So this whole discourse of multidimensional poverty and development also meant that much more work was needed at the grassroots level, much more research was needed at the grassroots level to understand the gaps, understand vulnerabilities, why people are vulnerable, why people are at a disadvantage vis-a-vis others, and to devise ways and means of empowering people to move out of this situation. In fact, the last point that I make here is that, you know, while earlier the approach was that if there are poor people, we will give them something. We will give them some food, we'll give them some medicines, we'll provide them with some services. But then the approach, you know, shifted to a new situation. I mean, the approach shifted to actually focusing on people's empowerment. So it is not enough to just give people something. It's more important to enable and empower people to actually move out of those situations of vulnerability and disadvantage. So with this, the NGO sector actually became very popular, very important, and very relevant in the context of developing economies like India. So coming to that, and I just wanted to say that today, as I've mentioned before, climate change, health, food security, gender inequality, these have become extremely important issues for the development sector. And a lot of these will actually be, thematics and that you will be studying in your economics courses. Now, I just wanted to map the careers in the development sector briefly. So some of the places, especially where you will have a lot of job opportunities. So as you can see, I've mapped about 5 kinds of spaces. One are the intervention level NGOs. The other is the research or think tanks. Another is the multilateral agencies. Another is campaigns and citizens forums. And the last are the government consultancies. So if you look at intervention NGOs, for example, you could have a national NGOs like Pradhan, Jagori, Priya. Priya is an NGO. Wait, I'll just give you here. It's called Participatory Research in Asia. Anandi, which is Area Networking and Development Initiative. So as you can see, all of these are working with development, and they really, really welcome economists with all their skills into these forums. At the level of international NGOs, which by the way are also very high paying, you have NGOs like ActionAid, you have NGOs like CARE, which is Cooperative for Assistance and Relief Everywhere, which works with emergency relief and long-term development. You have CRY, which is Child Rights in You. You have Oxfam. You have Plan India, which is also focusing on education, health, livelihoods, etc. So you have these big national and international NGOs, which provide a lot of employment to young professionals and to people who are actually coming with certain kinds of economics and other social science degrees. Next, you look at research or think tanks. So these are institutions which are specializing in research, impact evaluation, et cetera. So at the national level, you have organizations like iWage, which is Initiative for What Works to Advance Women and Girls in the Economy. You might see that I give a lot of examples from the gender space because that's my specialization and I'm a feminist economist and I work with gender and development. But you have a lot of organizations working on different thematics. So you have iWage, you have CPR, like the Center for Policy Research. You have CSDS, Center for Studies in Developing Societies. You have IHD, Center for Institute of Human Development. So these are certain examples that I'm giving. There are so many more. At the international level, there is, of course, ICRW, like the organization I come from, the International Center for Research on Women. You have JPAL, which is the Abdul Latif Jameel Poverty Action Lab, which is also led by our current Nobel laureate in economics, Abhijit Banerjee, who is an economist, of course. You have IFPRI, which is the International Food Policy Research Institute. You have OPM, which is the Oxford Policy Management Institute. You have, and so on and so forth. You have POP Council, which is Population Council, etc. Then there is a whole new domain of multilateral agencies. From the 1960s and 70s onwards, there are multilateral agencies led by the UN and its different branches across the world. So you have several organizations coming under UN, which looks at different thematics of development. And you also have the big banks, like the World Bank, like Asian Development Bank. And you so within the UN system, you have the ILO, which is looking at labor, so the International Labor Organization. You have UNDP, which is the United Nations Development Program. You have UNESCO, which is the United Nations Educational, Scientific and Cultural Organization. You have UNWFP, United Nations World Food Program, and so on and so forth. And you have, of course, UN Women, which is looking at gender issues. So every country, including India, has these organizational setups and you have a UN Women in India. And it looks at actually India, Maldives, Sri Lanka, etc. So it looks at that. For example, if you look at the research think tanks, the ICRW, this is our Asia office. So we can look at different countries across Asia, but the main office is in Delhi. Now coming to campaigns and citizens forums, as I had mentioned, there are big campaigns like Right to Work, Right to Food, where also researchers and students of economics find an opportunity. But you also have very big national campaigns like the National Alliance for People's Movements, the MKSS, which is led by Aruna Roy, who's the Magsaysay Award winner. So these kind of campaign groups and forums also employ a lot of students from economics. For example, I'm part of a campaign group, a citizen forum called the Feminist Policy Collective, which is actually a sort of an advocacy group where many of us are actually feminist economists who are working on how we can engender budgets that the government makes. So there are all these kinds of forums where there is also a need for economists. And then you have big, international campaigns like 1 Billion Rising. There is an alliance against 1 Billion Rising is against gender-based violence or violence against women. And there is a campaign called Alliance Against Inequality, which is led by Oxfam. And this is a global campaign where also we have certain people working within that campaign to create research and advocacy. Finally, you have government consultancies. So of course, a lot, you know, every government department and ministry, so ministry at the level of the center and in every state also, so in Karnataka, in West Bengal, everywhere, you have the state level departments of say rural development, women and child development. So they will employ consultants who will be doing this research work. So every government department also does research work of its own. So they actually employ consultants for coordination of events, for research work, and so on and so forth. Plus, you have very, very big government think tanks and research organizations like NCAR, which are very old institutions also, like who have been here for several, several decades. So you have National Council for Applied Economic Research, the NCAER. You have NIPFP, which is the National Institute of Public Finance and Policy. You have V.V. Giri National Labor Institute. And of course, in the last few years, we have seen the institution of Niti Aayog. So earlier, you might be knowing that that India used to make five-year plans, which we do not do anymore. But Niti Aayog instead is a think tank, which is actually helping in sort of looking at plans for the economy, looking at how to spend the government funds and the government money in different kinds of sectors. So Niti Aayog is a very, very big think tank of the government, which employs a lot of economists. I have given here two very, you know, like yesterday only when I was preparing the presentation. So I just opened the World Bank site and I was looking at employment opportunities in the World Bank site. And I know this is not very visible, but I'll just tell you. So on the left-hand panel, I have a World Bank employment opportunity webpage open, and I can see already that out of some, say, 7-8 opportunities, 4-5 are for economists. These are called for economists. On the right-hand side, I have a sort of a bio note of somebody working at JPAL, which I mentioned, which is an international level think tank research organization. So this is somebody called Shuddhoshottam Bhattacharya, who is actually a student of economics, who did his or her master, I'm not sure if it's a his or her, who did her master's in economics from Jadavpur University and also took a master's degree from abroad. So these are the kinds of sort of, just to give you a glimpse that at this moment, currently, if you go to the websites of these organizations, you will see that economists are in high demand. So this is, in fact, my last slide. So I wanted to say that economists are in high demand in the development sector. So one, because of their analytical skills and their conceptual understanding of issues such as poverty, labor, food security, health economics, public policy, which are very, very crucial for the development sector. Also because, you know, in economics, we have economic history, we have Indian economy, we have papers on all of these, which actually give you a whole idea about what has been India's journey in development and what has been the historical journey through colonial times till today. We have economic students come with conceptual understanding of government's plans, policies, and budgets. Also, because we live in a global world today, it's very important to understand the economics of globalization and liberalization and the need for inclusive growth. And economics students come with that conceptual and analytical understanding. Also, as I said before, that economic students come with skills for data collection, data management, data analysis of both primary data and large-scale macro data collected by organizations such as National Sample Survey Organization, etc. And finally, if you see that, you know, even for advocacy with government, economic students come with the skill of integrating evidence, meaning the research that we do, with public policy and including the understanding of budget. So when you're advocating with the government and you say, tell the government that you need to spend more in sort of giving women access to training and credit facilities, then you need to actually tell them from where in the budget can you take out this money, or how can you recover this money through your taxation. So this understanding of public policy, understanding of budgets, is the very, very important value that you add when you come into this development sector as an economist. So that is all from my side. So welcome to the world of economics. I hope many of you will be taking up this course, and I wish you all the very, very best. So over to you now, Aparajita.
Thank you, Nilanjana. That was a very comprehensive presentation, and you know, I'm sure the students got to know A, what are the kind of skills, what are the kind of knowledge base that economics provides for students to enter the development sector. And at the same time, students also, you know, you very well, you have put what is the scope of the development sector or what the students of economics can do in the development sector. So, you know, something that I was interested in, because, you know, this term that we are, you know, trying to, we are hearing very recently is evidence-based research, evidence-based policy. And I'm talking entirely from a teacher's perspective, that we want our students to find good jobs in the development sector, while at the same time, you know, the jobs also become meaningful for them, because, you know, it also satisfies them in a different way, that they are able to serve society. And with this evidence-based research, etc., I think the scope for economic students to enter the area is widening. So as a teacher, you know, what kind of courses do you think we can offer, you know, which will give our students a better launchpad to enter this area? Or even what kind of experiential learning options should we offer the students?
Thanks, Aparajita. I think that's a very interesting question. And since we have both worked at TIS together, I think this is something we have often sort of thought about, that how do we actually create good professionals who are also able to serve society in the best possible way? And in how do we create, I feel, you know, when we say evidence-based sort of advocacy, et cetera, just to say that, you know, what we mean is that, you know, suppose we are asking the government to make a change in their policy, it needs to be backed by actually evidence. If we are saying that, see, there are so many people who do not have access to hospitals, you need to make better hospitals, let's say, then we need to really do research to see that what is the current infrastructure in the hospital, how many people are accessing the hospital, what kind of money they are having to pay if they are not going to the hospital, how much money are they spending with private doctors, or are they at all going to private doctors, or is it, you know, there are certain customary you know, practices where they don't go to doctors, they are using some customary medicines and etc. And what is the what is the cost benefit analysis, let's say, of actually spending on building a hospital? I mean, what is the cost to the government and the benefit to the society, let's say? So going beyond the narrow cost benefit analysis that we do in economics. So if, you know, somewhere I feel, first of all, I think wherever we are teaching, whatever we are teaching in our courses. So if you are teaching, let's say, a course on public finance, then we also need to also give them concrete examples, looking at current budgets and how money is being spent, or, you know, looking at the previous budget and how that has changed, how the budgets are changing with the changing in the priorities of the government. When we are teaching employment, let us look at some of the very important and critical questions today. So let's talk about informal sector and the conditions of workers in informal sectors. Or let's talk about why there is, such abyss. So for example, India is even behind Bangladesh and Pakistan in terms of women's workforce participation rate in the country. Why is that happening? So to bring in absolutely current and relevant issues into whatever course or we are teaching, I think that's one very important point. And the other very important point I feel in terms of experiential learning is when they do their term papers or their, I don't know whether they have a dissertation that they do, to actually go into the field to sort of study the field, to be part of the field, to collect actual primary data and to do research with the help of that primary data. Also to work with certain organizations, you know, as interns, etc. I don't know what the system would be, but to also maybe spend a couple of months in each year or over the course of 2 years or 3 years with certain organizations working on development issues or issues relevant to what they are learning in these courses, to actually get an on-ground experience of how things are working on the ground. So I think these are very important for students to really understand the meaning of what they are learning, you know, to relevance of what they are learning. Yeah.
I just have one more question. That is, you see, right now we are focusing on an undergraduate course. So what is, you know, I just want to ask that in the development sector, what would be the entry level for a student? You know, like we had similar conversation with data analytics experts, and they think that, you know, you should have a master's degree in economics. But in the development sector, because I think it is a wider field. So, you know, what is the entry level and what are the differences in an undergraduate degree holder and, say, a postgraduate degree holder?
So, Aparajita, I think one of the spaces where there is definitely a lot of opportunities, even for undergrad students, is the space of interventions and the space of campaigns and collaborations. So when there are several organizations who are working at the grassroots level. So sometimes, often, in fact, I've seen several students who take a break between their undergrad and master's also because they want to get some experience on the field. So after your undergrad, I think interventions is a space where you definitely have a lot of opportunities. They are not really looking at master students and stuff like that. They just want students to come with a certain understanding of social science and a commitment to actually bring about change. So that's what they are looking at. And this training in economics, actually, because it gives them some conceptual sort of tools to analyze, etc., it's very useful in this intervention work. And also in collaborations and campaigns, because there also you are trying to bring people together, develop the idea of a campaign, build pressure groups. And, you know, I feel this experience even after undergrad becomes very, very relevant because you actually see that, okay, I've read about poverty, but I've actually see how people are working to enable people to move out of poverty, or how certain campaigns are being built to sort of tackle the issue of poverty. So it makes it much more real for students, and they can also apply a lot of their understanding and knowledge in the field through this. So I think these are two spaces. But yes, for research think tanks, etc., I think the preference is that you would hold a master's degree.
Thank you for being here with us. And in our curriculum also, we are trying to find ways in which our students can engage more closely with the experts from the specific domain. So we hope, you know, we will have many future opportunities to interact with you, and students also will have opportunities to interact with you. So thank you very much for today's
session. Thank you. My pleasure. Thank you.